is something new, the Casper Slide Part 2, featuring the Platinum Band. And this time, we're gonna get funky. 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 Everybody clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. All right, now, we're gonna do the basic step. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. One hop this time. Right foot, let's stomp. Left foot, let's stomp. Cha-cha, real smooth. Turn it out. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. One hop this time. Right foot, let's stomp. Two stumps. Slide to the left. Slide to the right. Crisscross. crisscross. Cha-cha, real smooth. Let's go to work.
All right. Welcome, everybody, to the final PowerPoint of Human Anatomy. I'm hanging out here with DJ Casper, the originator of the cha-cha slide. And you guys are very close to be doing the cha-cha slide after this PowerPoint and the final exam. So let's get to it with the foot and ankle. And we've got a couple different pictures here. We've got a surface anatomy picture of the foot and the ankle, very similar to the wrist and the hand, but we'll look at a lot of differences as well. Here you can see an x-ray radiograph of the different bones that make up the ankle and the foot. Here you can see some drawings of these things. Notice how the tibia comes down and is the major bone that connects with the talus, that first part of the midfoot is what we would call it. So all these bones in here, circle them on this picture that has the talus removed, are the tarsal bones. Carpal's in your wrist, tarsal's in your ankle and your foot. So these are the tarsal bones, calcaneus, talus. Talus is your heel. Talus is the heel. And then you have the navicular, the cuboid, and don't, Professor Klein, don't forget about the cuneiforms. Those are part of the tarsal bones as well. Instead of metacarpals, we've got metatarsals. Metatarsals, big toe is one, all the way over to five. And then just like the fingers, they're actually called the same thing, the phalanges of the foot. Phalanges being the toes. But also notice on here how you can see a lot of the different tendons popping out of the foot, such as the tibialis anterior that we've talked about. You can see the extensor digitorum, longus, a few other ones here as well as the different joints of the foot itself. So instead of the MCP joint, because these are tarsals, this would be the MTP joint. So MTP, metatarsal phalangeal joint. And then just like before, you've got the PIP and the DIP of the phalanges related to the toes. All right, so let's look specifically at what technically is the ankle. Now, the ankle is technically the talocrural joint. When we say tallow, or I say tallow, I want you to think of talus. This talus bone right here, that's the talus. Put a big T on the talus. And crural, crural is the crural region of the body. That's the leg. So the crural would be the leg. The talus is the tallow. This is the ankle joint right here. When you're going to dorsiflex, plantar flex, it's going to be doing movement right at this joint. And what it's saying down here is essentially there's some differences between dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. A little bit more stable during dorsiflexion to a degree, and a little bit more unstable during plantar flexion, specifically related to the talocrural articulation. While we're looking at the slide here, is a great shot of the calcaneus, the heel bone. This would be what most oftenly contacts the ground when you heel strike. So what's holding all these bones together? Well, the passive stabilizers are our ligaments. Let's talk about a lot of the ligaments in the ankle. Here's the ligaments divided into three different groups. You've got the lateral ligaments, you've got the deltoid ligament on the medial side, so lateral medial, and then you've got some ligaments of the tibiofibular syndesmosis. We'll talk about that special group number three as well. All right, so let's look at the lateral ligaments first. I've numbered them 1 through 6. I'll close my box real quick so you can see all those properly. But let's look first at the anterior talofibular. This one I'll say is the most commonly torn or sprained ligament of the ankle. So remember the anterior talofibular ligament. And just like any other ligament, if you cut it in half, tallow, meaning the talus, fibular, meaning the fibula, that's this ligament right there. Now I'm gonna jump to number four, because number four is the same thing, but it's posterior. So you got one anterior, you got one posterior. Number one and four, they're partners, and you can kind of connect those in the one group as well. With that being said, number two and three are the same as well. Tibiofibular. Tibio is the tibia. Fibular, the fibula. One's anterior, one's posterior, and those connect, as you can see here, to the two bones. The next two, though, are separate. Calcaneofibular, calcaneus, and the fibula, that's this ligament. And then, as you guessed it, talocalcaneal, going from the calcaneus to the talus. So check out those six, pause the video, draw this out, and see if you can name all six ligaments of the lateral side of the ankle that I want you to know. All right, next up, the medial perspective here. Let's look at the medial side. On the medial side, we've got a collection of ligaments that kind of form together to form what we call the deltoid ligament. The deltoid ligament, also referred to as the medial ligament, is a combination of four different ligaments. And guess what? It's the first four that I've labeled here. So one, two, three, four. Those four make up the deltoid ligament. Let's look at each of them individually. First up, the tibiotalar, posterior tibiotalar. That's this one right here, from the tibia to the talus. Next up, tibionavicular. Tibio is coming from the tibia down to the navicular bone. So this one is over here, kind of this triangular shaped ligament. They overlap, so it's not as triangular as it might look, but that is the tibionavicular. Next up, the tibiocalcaneal. Tibiocalcaneal, that's this one in the middle. And let me give you some numbers so that you can keep track of these. Number three right here, it's going from the tibia to the calcaneus. And number four, if you had a posterior tibiotalar, you've got an anterior tibiotalar coming out in this direction right here. Number four, labeled there for you, from the tibia to the talus. Tibia to the talus, tough to really see that one, but it is right there, number four. And don't let this picture throw you off. It looks like that's going to the navicular bone, but it really isn't. Let me even redraw that for you. It's really this one over here that makes up number four. All right, so those four make up the deltoid ligament. How about these next two? These next two are more horizontal. Looks like I'm doing the dance again. It's horizontal, and they are the long plantar ligament and the spring ligament. So the long plantar going all the way across here, and then the spring ligament right there. So that long plantar is going from the calcaneus all the way over to the third, fourth, and fifth metatarsal. Don't let this picture confuse you. The long plantar is underneath the foot itself. There is a short plantar right in there. You guys can see where I'm drawing that in. That's a short plantar. I'll undo that so you can see it. And the other name for the spring ligament is the plantar calcaneonavicular. I had to read that one off. Plantar calcaneonavicular ligaments. And in the last picture down here, this posterior view, really just a lot of the same ligaments that we've been looking at, but from a posterior view. Here's another zoom in of the lateral side. As you can see, that most commonly torn one, the anterior talofibular ligament. We'll talk about in a little bit why that's most commonly torn. And here's that medial side, looking at the four that make up the deltoid ligament, as you can see down here, as well as those spring and long and short plantar ligaments. And finally, the posterior look as well. So make sure you know all those ligaments that I just mentioned, how to name them, what two bones they go together, and obviously the most commonly torn one as well. Now we're on to the ankle movements. As you can see here, let's just recap. We've been hitting these all throughout the semester, but if we recap, we've got dorsiflexion right here, and dorsiflexion can even become more like that. But then plantar flexion is the opposite. It's pointing the toes away from the shin. But then up here we can see eversion and inversion. Try this out in your own feet here. Try this out. See if you can do eversion and inversion. If we look at the bones themselves, here we can see the eversion and the inversion going medially versus laterally. Sometimes you can think of it as, what direction does your foot turn, or the plantar side of your foot point towards? And that's what they're talking about with laterally and medially. So remember those actions as we focus in more on ankle sprains. And the fourth time mentioning it, but again, the most commonly torn ligament of the ankle is the anterior talofibular. Think you step off a curb, your plantar flex, and you invert. So we've got inversion and plantar flexion going on with the ankle, and that is how you sprain that ligament. Here we can see that rolled ankle happening in action. If you look up here, right at the ankle, you'll notice inversion, a little bit of plantar flexion, probably when they were stepping down, gonna tear probably that anterior talofibular ligament. All right, let's move on from the ankle ligaments and get into the different divisions of the foot. And when we're looking at the foot, it's all about shock absorption. Your foot is the first thing to contact the ground. And when it contacts the ground, we know Newton's laws, the force that you put into an object, in this case, the ground, it's gonna put the same force back up, in this case, through your foot. So the foot's gotta be able to absorb shock from the ground or many other things as well, and adapt to any surface, hard surface, soft surface, rough surface. If you're in Athens, the bricks of Athens. So you gotta keep it stable as well to propel your body forward. The pushing off of the foot moves you when you walk, run, sprint, jump, whatever it might be. So the three main sections are the forefoot, the midfoot, and the hind foot. So the forefoot is this section up here, metatarsals, phalanges. Think of it as your toes. When someone says run on your toes, those are your toes that they're talking about, are the forefoot. And they really adapt to the level of the ground. The midfoot, now we're talking about your tarsals, middle of the foot, all about stability and mobility. If you don't have stability and mobility here, your foot will not have that stability and mobility. And then finally, the hind foot, basically calcaneus, talus, that is the heel, often referred to as the heel or the hind foot of the foot. All right, in the sagittal plane, you can also divide the foot into a medial side and a lateral side, or medial rays and lateral rays. So let me just draw a line down where it divides of the foot. Now we can see the medial rays, the lateral rays, and really what it does is creates a medial and lateral arch. So we think of this medial side as an arch, the lateral side as an arch. Well, guess what? There's one more arch, the transverse arch as well. So I wrote it in there for you, transverse arch going across, but then you got that medial and that lateral arch as well, all absorbing vertical loads. So I said, ground coming up, but guess what? You got body weight coming down as well. So if I haven't emphasized it enough, the foot has got to be strong. It's got to be stable to absorb all these forces. And guess what? It's got a lot of things that will do that for us, beginning with the fascia. The fascia is on the dorsal side as well as the plantar side. So this is a plantar view or inferior view of the foot. And the main fascia that we've got here is called the plantar aponeurosis, aka the plantar fascia. This one's near and dear to my heart because I have had numerous injuries with the plantar fascia, which I will outline right here for you. It's a thick, thick band of fascia on the bottom of the foot holding all the muscles up against the bones and up against the arches. It's going to give structure to the foot as well as protection. It's thick because if you walk around barefoot, it's got to have some protection against the interior or deeper structures. Exam question for you. The plantar fascia supports what arches? In this case, it'd be the longitudinal arches. This is the lateral arch. This would be the medial arch. So the plantar fascia does both the medial and the lateral longitudinal arches. A few more joints before we move on. We talked about the tallow crural joint that is shown here. We also have something called the subtalar joint. This is technically the talar calcaneal joint, which is shown right in here, but it's got a special name, subtalar, below the talus. Now there's a ton of other joints. I'm not going to ask you to memorize these or know these except for the MTP and the IP joints out here in the forefoot. And in the forefoot, we've got that flexion and extension. You can flex your toes, you can extend your toes, just like the fingers. Not as much mobility because your toes aren't as long, but you can still do those actions. Let's zoom out and get another picture of that with some ligaments back in here. And here you can see that plantar fascia or plantar aponeurosis running from the calcaneus all the way up to the phalanges up there. One of those tarsal joints that I do want to mention is the talonavicular, as shown right here, in the calcaneocuboid, as shown right here. It'd be the opposite from a dorsal view versus a plantar view. And I mentioned those joints because now we can start to talk about, in addition to the ligaments, the way the bones are designed give it structure. For example, the talus is often referred to as the keystone, or rather this part of the talus is the keystone. And I'm not talking about the alcoholic beverage. I'm talking about the fact that a keystone in a bridge is where it holds the bridge together. The fact that this one is in the middle and it is supporting the right side and the left side, it's the brick or the stone that holds that bridge together. So one of the ways that you get stability in the foot are the bone structures. The second way, so this is one way, the second way, we already talked about the ligaments. That's like staples on a bridge. Now, we never staple a bridge, but if we did, or put some metal through it, which they actually do, then that would be like the ligaments of the foot, adding extra support. But we can continue on and say there's more to it, because sometimes you have a suspension bridge. You have wires that pull the bridge up to try to support the arch or take some weight off the bridge itself. That's like the lower leg muscles, like the peroneus longus pulling up from the leg on the ankle and the foot areas. Now the peroneus longus has to contract as an active stabilizer to do this. And lastly, we've got the tie beams of a bridge. In this case, these are the transverse or horizontal ligaments of the foot, such as the spring ligament. All right, let's start to make a list of what supports what arch. And in this case, we've already talked about a few of them, but let's talk about them again. The long plantar and the short plantar, it's doing the lateral arch, the lateral arch of our foot. The medial arch, we're talking about the spring ligament. The medial arch is the spring ligament here. And we mentioned before, I did the plantar aponeurosis is both sides. So add plantar aponeurosis to both of the arches. And if we keep going, we know those ligaments are passive stabilizers and the muscles are active stabilizers. Here's a list of a lot of our active stabilizers of the arches of the foot. So I've put either an M for medial or L for lateral or both for some of these muscles, but we will talk about these muscles later on. So let's talk about that transverse arch. One of the main muscles that stabilizes the transverse arch is the adductor hallucis transverse head. The transverse head is going to do the transverse arch. It's going across transversely, but the oblique head, now we're talking more about the medial longitudinal arch with that one. Notice the fibularis longus is coming down and around. That's going to be transverse as well as lateral. Transverse as well as lateral because it's coming down the lateral side. Tibialis posterior, though, that's going to be medial. That's coming down the medial side. Don't forget also about the plantar ligaments that run transversely across the metatarsals and the proximal phalanges. So here is that fibularis longus again coming down and around and across transverse lateral arch. Here we can see just the lateral arch for the, just the medial arch for the tibialis posterior tendon, one of the main muscles for that medial arch. All right, take a second, pause for a second, try to go back, try to do those ligaments, try to map this out a little bit. There's not a ton of individual muscles of the foot coming up, but we will recap some groups together here. Your book does an awesome, awesome job of taking a look at each muscle. So here we can see a plantar view or an inferior view of the foot. All these muscles, or a lot of these muscles, are going to be acting together. So during the stance phase of walking, when you've got weight on your foot, you're going to be contracting a majority of these muscles to make sure your foot doesn't collapse and that it stays strong with those longitudinal arches. So we got the lateral arch over here, the medial arch over here. Hey, here's that abductor hallucis I mentioned earlier. Abductor hallucis, that's going to be the medial. Let me put an M and an L right there. We also have the tibialis posterior. Hopefully you're getting your list together of some of these arches and the muscles that help support the arches. Looking at the lateral side, we can see things like the abductor digiti minimi. That's going to abduct the pinky toe, right? The fifth digit, abduct the pinky toe. We also have the fibularis longus coming down laterally for that. Don't forget the flexor digiti minimi as well. It flexes the pinky toe on the foot. All right. I've mapped them out again for you. 1, 2, 3, 4 on the lateral side, 3 on the medial side that we can see here. I'm going to highlight the abductor hallucis, this muscle. This is one of the most important muscles when it comes to strengthening the medial arch. Try it for a second. Try to just abduct your big toe. If you can do that, I'd be impressed, but it takes a lot of mental effort to really contract this muscle. but it is very important. We also have another one on here, the flexor digitorum brevis. So we've got a flexor digitorum longus sneaking its way down and going out to the toes, but we also have that flexor digitorum brevis doing the same thing. We've got two muscles to flex the toes. Let's keep looking deeper here, and here we can actually see that flexor digitorum longus coming down, going to each digit. The brevis connects right to it, but notice the longus has this muscle called the quadratus plantae that it's attached to. So the quadratus plantae, it's also an important one to pull in this direction on that tendon to make sure this tendon doesn't go off the foot. So the quadratus plantae is very important for the flexor digitorum longus. Keep going deeper here and keep removing some muscles, and eventually you see the flexor hallucis brevis, the medial and lateral heads here for those two. They do the same thing, but they're innervated by different nerves we'll look at later. I mentioned the adductor hallucis earlier. It's got an oblique head and a transverse head. It's going to adduct the big toe. You'll also notice plantar and dorsal interossei, pad dab, same thing, but now instead of palmar, it's plantar. With that, as well as the opponent's digiti minimi over there as well. Do notice that if we're looking at the flexor digitorum longus, it's going all the way to the distal phalanx or distal phalange, but that flexor digitorum brevis, guess what? Just like up top in the hand, it's going to stop at the middle phalange. All right, here are the gait cycle slides. These I'm going to make optional because this is more kinesiology, less of just the anatomy. I know it's tough enough just to get the muscle names down and their actions and their innervations and all that stuff. If you're interested in the gait cycle and how we use the muscles to walk and run and sprint, come talk to me. I love to talk about that stuff. But as you cycle through, you can see different muscles are acting in different ways to stabilize and push off and take on the weight of different things here. But again, I will make the gait cycle optional. But we will want to talk about the nerve innervation of the foot. And we've got the medial and lateral plantar nerve coming down from the tibial nerve in the calf, posterior chamber of the lower leg, and it splits, and we can see it goes into these two nerves. We also have some arteries that are coming down here. So remember the arteries coming down the leg, popliteal in the back, splitting, and eventually we get to the dorsal pedis artery and the plantar artery. Dorsal pedis is really important as this top part of the foot. That's oftentimes where a pulse is taken in the foot to see if blood is flowing properly to the feet, as well as the posterior tibial artery. Posterior tibial artery, there's another spot that is easy to take the pulse. Our final few slides talking about the clinical things. This is the one that I've struggled with for years, but not for the last 7 years since I learned how to strengthen and stretch the muscles I needed to prevent against plantar fasciitis. What is plantar fasciitis? It's strain and inflammation of the plantar aponeurosis. So if you feel inflammation on that plantar fascia and it's painful and you can't push off and you can't walk, that's plantar fasciitis. But I've got a list of things that can cause it: running, high impact, improper footwear. But I'll tell you what, all those things are not the true cause. The true cause of any injury is stressing a muscle or a ligament or a fascia or a bone or whatever beyond its limit. Now, if you run 200 miles or 100 miles in a week and you've never run before, you know, pretty much guaranteed that's probably over your limit. But I've known a lot of runners who can run hundreds and hundreds of miles and not have any issues because they spent years and years strengthening those muscles so that they can handle those forces. So what I'm saying is running or high impact aerobics or whatever, that's not the true cause. The true cause is that the muscle just cannot handle the stress that you place upon it. So make sure you strengthen some muscles, and we'll talk about why in a moment. There's also a plantar reflex going on in the foot, as well as a Babinski sign, things to test the feet to see if they're functioning properly. Here's another look at the nerve, checking your book for the differences in the nerves and the muscles. But what this slide is really saying is, how do you really compress one nerve or the other? Well, down here you can see if you evert a ton, put a lot of pressure on this side, then you're gonna have some medial nerve entrapment. And sometimes with runners, if they don't have a strong foot, it will collapse that arch and put a lot of pressure on that medial nerve that we can see there. So you get some aching, some burning, some numbness on that medial side. So what do? Well, strengthen that abductor hallucis, right? Strengthen the abductor hallucis, keep the arch strong, and you won't have these. You can also compress the tibial nerve by the flexor retinaculum. Guess what? We've got retinaculums around the ankle as well that keep those tendons close to the ankle, but the tibial nerve coming down, splitting into the medial and lateral plantar, can also be entrapped by that flexor retinaculum. Let me highlight it here for you. Flexor retinaculum. Here's that nerve coming down and over there. You can fracture the fibula, definitely. And don't forget about the lateral and medial malleolus. You can have malleolar fractures, specifically when you force inversion onto the foot, it can fracture these bones. How about eversion? Yeah, eversion as well. It's called a pot fracture. It's a dislocation of the ankle where you got both things getting cut. Forced eversion is big on this one. Pulls that medial ligament, breaks the medial ligament, and moves the talus laterally, breaking some bones. And lastly, I do want to say flat feet or pes planus, something that I have, born with it, dealt with it, had some injuries from it, overcome it, and now I use it as an advantage. But that specifically is the talus rotating anteriorly, anteriorly, but also inferiomedially for the talus to make that flat foot. So what's one of the main ways to strengthen your foot? It's called the foot crunch. Try this out. Let's take a look. All right, watching this here, watch how the medial arch and the other arches just kind of bridge on up. That's the foot crunch. I'll play it again from the beginning. Notice the arch going on right here. Give it a second. There it is. Notice that arch. You can build yourself an arch. That's what I had to do. And we'll talk in our small professional groups about why building an arch is important with, let's say, the prevention of plantar fasciitis. Well, that's the end of the foot and the ankle PowerPoint and the end of all the lecture videos for human anatomy class. You've done a great job and we've made it this far. Keep going all the way through the final and you can do...
Take it back now, y'all. Five hops this time. Right foot, let's stop. Left foot, let's stop. right foot again.